Put it over here. Okay, I can't see it. Welcome to the Hearst Castle.
Oh, it's okay.
We are on the bus.
I'm used to traveling with some
shadows. There you are. Hey, hello.
This is Hearst Castle, and once the home of newspaper publisher William Randolph Hearst. In a few moments about the Enchanted Hill, when it was in its heyday. You will hear about Hearst, his family, Julia Morgan, the architect of the estate, and many of the events that occurred here during the 1920s and 30s. Right now, we would like to provide you with some background information about San Simeon.
As efficient as possible. He directed his architect, Julia Morgan, to develop the sleepy village of San Simeon and the ranch operation so that he, his guests and employees, could live in comfort. Residences were built on San Simeon Bay for the construction superintendent, head groundskeeper, and ranch manager. A bunkhouse for the single men who worked on the ranch, in the orchards, or at the poultry farm was constructed nearby. An important component of the area's development was the collection, storage, and transport of water. An extensive system of wells, reservoirs, and pipelines was developed beginning in the 1920s and continuing to this day.
Sorry about that. Oh, here we are. Look at the olive. Jeez. Orange trees. Oh, boy.
Here's the steps they were talking about.
Yeah. Lots of them. Beautiful.
Move forward a little bit so that everyone can get off the stairs. We don't want anybody rolling back to the visitor center before you've had the tour. All right. Well, I'm Denise Serber, and I'd like to welcome you on behalf of the California Department of Parks and Recreation to Hearst San Simeon State Historical Monument, which I think we all know as Hearst Castle. Even though Mr. Hearst never called it that, he always called it the ranch at San Simeon. I'd also thank everyone for visiting us today, because when you buy that ticket, you help us in our effort to preserve and protect the home of William Randolph Hearst and the artwork that he collected that we are going to be able to see today. They play a tape for you as you came up on the hill.
Yep.
I need to review a few of the guidelines. This is a house museum. Why he called it that? You can take either stairway on either side of this little fountain.
Oh my. Thank you.
Harry Truman was president. Mr. Hearst was the only son, only child of George and Phoebe Apperson Hearst. Now, the family was newly wealthy. George Hearst made his initial fortune in the mining industry, silver mine, Comstock Lode in Nevada. Phoebe Hearst, Phoebe Apperson Hearst, William's mother, was a very interesting woman. She was self-educated, very interested in arts, culture. She was the one that gave him a lifelong interest in art and collecting art. She was a collector herself. William was married when he, just before he turned 40 years of age in 1903, and he married Millicent Wilson. She was a New York, she was into the arts. She was a showgirl, actually, a dancer. They had five boys, but by the mid-1920s, late 1920s, they decided to separate. Millicent lived in New York on Long Island in a large estate with the five boys. Mr. Hearst was spending a lot of his time here in California where he could do some of the other things that he was interested in, spent a lot of time here at this estate, and most of the time was with an actress, Marion Davies. He was, he and Marion were companions for nearly 30 years by the time he died in 1951. Mr. Hearst had at least three careers during his lifetime. He was a very major, very influential publisher, many newspapers and magazines in his publishing empire. He was also a movie producer. He was also a politician. And although it's not really a career, he was a very avid collector of art, strong avocation, and treated it almost as if it were a career. He was a builder, whether he was building the publishing empire, the movie career, political base, an art collection, or the estate that we see here today. Very creative man. No matter what he was doing, he was good at taking existing concepts, existing ideas, existing pieces of art, putting them together in a way that was new and unique. Now, he inherited the property here, the ranch at San Simeon. In 1919, when his mother died, very quickly he began making plans to build a small summer cottage here on Camp Hill where he had come as a boy. And he looked to an architect that had worked for his mother. Her name was Julia Morgan, very well educated, first woman to obtain a degree in civil engineering from the University of California at Berkeley, first woman to obtain a certificate in architecture from the School of Fine Arts in Paris, in France. Well, very soon, they began talking about not just this summer cottage idea, but a major estate which turned into three guest cottages and a main house. And it must have been a really good working relationship that Mr. Hearst had with Ms. Morgan, because they stuck with it for about 30 years. She was the only architect that she had. He left in 1947 due to health reasons, and she was still his architect at that time. Now, they started building the guest houses, the three of them, in 1920. And this, by the way, is a guest house. This is not the main attraction. We'll go through part of that guest house before we go through the main house. The main house, they started in 1922. Construction continued on until 1947 when Mr. Hearst left due to health reasons. It was always a work in progress, never finished. You see evidence of that. Partly because there were new additions, changes. Mr. Hearst also changed his mind a lot. You'll see evidence of that as well. Now, I'd like you to take yourself back in time. It's no longer 1997. It's 60 years ago. 1937. You are all guests of Mr. Hearst on the Hill. And I don't even have to ask you to pretend that it's a hot summer afternoon, do I? What would be a good activity on a hot summer afternoon?
A swim.
A swim, did I hear?
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's take a look at the ranch pool. It would be nice, wouldn't it? It's a great day for us, man, wouldn't it? Well, this is the Neptune Pool. It was designed for Mr. Hearst by Julia Morgan, his architect. It's 104 feet long, 58 feet wide, or 95 feet wide if you go all the way to the end of the alcove where there's a grouping of statuary. That's called the Birth of Venus. And it was sculpted in the 1920s by
by Charles Cassou, a French sculptor in the Art Deco style. Even though it was a classic of paint.
Now, we're standing on what is called the Neptune Terrace, and we're right on top of those 17 dressing rooms that I mentioned. The terrace was designed to be a nice place where you might come on an afternoon, have a cup of coffee or tea, and relax maybe with some of the other visitors, and enjoy the natural surroundings. We even have some natural surroundings right in here in the landscaped gardens, because Mr. Hurst had a great fondness for the native plant life that found up here, that was here long before he started building. So for example, we have a grove of native California Bay Laurel that this terrace was built right out around that. We didn't want anything moved. We also have a California live oak here. Again, we didn't want anything cut down or moved in order to accommodate. We didn't mind moving things, but he didn't want them cut down in order to accommodate the construction that was going on here. Now right over there is the guest house we saw when we were down on the west terrace. It's one of three. Mr. Hurst and Ms. Morgan refer to this, for convenience sake, as C house. They refer to the other two as A house and B house. They also had more elaborate descriptive names. This one was Casa del Sol, House of the Sun, named because it faces west, and in the late afternoon or early evening, you have a glorious view of the sunset over the Pacific Ocean. Now, the three guest houses were going to be designed in the Mediterranean Renaissance style and Christian elements of art as they ended up in Spain. Now, the balcony is not really just a 15th century piece. Ms. Morgan, the architect, had to extend it along the sides. She also had to...
Casa de Grande, moon house. I know I was going through a guest house.
Barbara, this is some garden. Look at this thing. Whoa.
I think those are sprinkler heads rather than microphones. Mm. They're lights. No, they're lights. Well, I got lights in.
Look at that desk.
Oh, this is the bedroom I have on that view. Yeah. Oh, jeez. Got a fireplace.
Fireplace.
Yeah. View of the pool.
Oh, yeah.
Look at that sand.
Oh, look at there's a stairway from the closet.
Oh, look at this one.
Is this a guest house or
what? Here's the tapestries over here.
The bar room. Yeah, fourth. Yeah.
Look, it's Tashi. Tasha who? Who? Jesus Christ.
I'm sorry.
Oh my God. Taj Mahal.
Yeah, I heard a castle. I also heard a church. I heard a cathedral. Well,
this house needed to have Carolyn Bell. So he ordered those up in 1920 from Belgium. There were 18 in each tower.
Damn. Sure, where?
That she thought she had found just the place for this little Madonna.
Where is it?
I don't know.
Where took me? The Duke of Burgundy goes to White. Now, that was a 15th century statue made out of stone. It's starting to show wear and tear from the weathering and such. So, this is a modern reproduction. We have the original in our protective vault. It's made, of course, in France. Now, looking down a little further,
about an hour to get to San Luis Obispo, and then I'd give myself about 3 hours to get down to San Luis.
Okay, what if we jump on 101?
Designed and implemented extensions along all of the sides. They're made out of cast plastic.
itself was made out of walnut carved. Painted the plaster to make it look like walnut. Pretty hard to tell where the old 16th century stops and the new 20th century. Time when, in history, when approximately 75% of the American public was attending religious ceremonies.
Speedy.
What? There's the elevator.
What?
There's the elevator.
Oh, this is an elevator.
Like a beautiful rose, might have been maybe a christening dress or something like that. And this was very special kind of gift wrapping, essentially. It's made out of rock crystal and has gilt on it, also ebony, lapis lazuli, all of that sort of thing. It's either French or Italian, we're not sure which, probably Italian though, 16th century. Now this, pardon me, the round on the either end, those were medallions. They are, I believe they're 19th century, and done by Torvaldsen, a Danish artist. I think they're marble. Now, this is the refectory, or the dining room. Mr. Hurst would lead his guests in here, and he would come to this side of the table. He would be seated right here, one of these two seats in the middle. Across from him would be his companion, the actor's American baby. If you had just recently arrived,
please don't use flash.
If you had just recently arrived, you would probably be seated very close to him, possibly next to him, or his babies. As your stay wore on, you would find yourself further down the table. Mr. Hurst liked to have guests that were more recently elected. Notice what those flags, those banners do. They give him the arch that he was looking for, and also some bright color for the dining room. Those are also Italian silk banners. They represent neighborhoods in the city of Siena, Italy, that every year has a horse race. These are used by various contestants to represent those. Now after dinner, Mr. Hurst would offer his guests a full-length motion picture. On the way to the movie palace, they would usually have time for a cup of coffee.
When this guy had a barbecue. He had a barbecue. Okay, it's easy enough to worry about your ass being too big to sit in this.